Dear friends and people of Odisha, greetings to you from India and welcome to this gathering. I wish I could visualize this assembly of goodwill, but I can only imagine it. So, swagatam in Sanskrit. I have been asked by my friends to give in a way of very brief introduction, to say something about the backdrop of culture of Odisha, because you are about to witness some items reflecting certain aspects of that vast range of culture. As you all know, the culture of Odisha could not have originated with the formation of the present state of Odisha in 1936. It goes back to mythical times. Well, when the land was far extended beyond the present boundaries of Odisha, sometimes it has incredibly extended from Ganga to Godavari, sometimes it has shrunk. But the culture has developed through vicissitudes of time, and I will do justice neither to history nor to you if I try to give any kind of impression about the past culture in a few minutes. Better I confine myself to one or two very basic issues, basic points in Odisha culture, which have really sometimes overwhelmed me with their inner significance. You know, the land has changed, people have changed, rulers have changed, but over the years, over the centuries, over the millennia, I should say, certainly we know about 3,000 years, one single factor around which the psyche of Odisha has revolved, and that is Sri Jagannath, the presiding deity of the land. Now, you know, it's a strange form. It does not conform to any of the established the models of either Krishna or Rama or Shiva or any of the well-known figures of deities. It is something strange, something unusual. But what has surprised me is this, that through the ages, great prophets belonging to different disciplines, exponents of Dvaita, Advaita, Vishishtadvaita, exponents of Mayavada, of Buddhism, of different schools of yoga, whoever have come there, they have somehow felt in this deity what they sought, what they aspired to see, what they would be satisfied by realizing. This cannot be said about any other institution, to my knowledge, anywhere in the world, not only to speak of India. But that apart, there is another element which often people don't remember, and which is an element of a philosophy, or rather a discipline of self-effacement, complete self-forgetfulness, trying to nullify one's ego. You know, when the temple, present temple, is not the first citadel inside which Jagannath is to be found. The old temple is gone. Several temples have gone over the times. In mythical times, there was a legendary king, Indradyumna. When, that is a long story again, it is worthy, the subject is worthy of being the matter for a colossal epic. This is not the occasion to recount it. But the mythical king Indradyumna, who discovered the essence of the deity, the Brahma, as we call it, which is in Navipadma, at the navel of the present, well, structure of the deity. Now, when he discovered it is believed that it is relics of Sri Krishna, and worshipped as Nilavadhava in a village called Kantilo. That was a forest in those days. When he discovered it, and brought the most precious object he sought and enshrined it in the in a temple, a temple which is no longer there. The first boon when the deity came to, we can say, when Jivanyasa was given, when the deity came to life, say, the physical image became vibrant with the consciousness of Brahma. He sought a strange boon from him. Bless me, that I will have no descendant, I will have no heir, no line of descendants who can feel proud of an ancestor like me, the founder of this deity, this temple, and take advantage of this heredity, this heritage. It is a strange ever, I mean the most unusual boon one can think of. He wants the dynasty to end with himself. Well, he was a yogi, of course, and this sense of effacement, self-effacement, somehow I have always felt it has remained ingrained in the inner consciousness of the people of this land. When sometime in 3rd century BC, Ashoka came and invaded this country, this land. You know, tens of thousands of people were killed. A ferocious war was fought. If there had been no war, Ashoka would have simply annexed it to his empire. He had no business to kill tens of thousands of people and take prisoner tens of thousands of people. He did it. His own declaration reveals it. But who fought? Who are the kings? Or who are the leaders of this great army? We never know about it. There is no inscription left about it, nowhere. Though earlier inscriptions are also discovered now. The people, this spirit of self-effacement, it was somehow ingrained in the entire the sub-nation's mind. It never projected itself under true leader in the name of a great king. In those days, at least, things have changed by the time. Time has rolled on. So I have always seen that I have always felt that these are some of the basic traits, unique traits of the people we call the people of Odisha. Today we'll see some culture, some aspects of our culture. A classical Odissi dance also is included in it. Now, the literature of Orissa, paintings of Orissa, dances of Orissa, all have originated with this deity as the symbol, as the center. The female devotees, ecstatic female devotees with devotion, they were dancing out their emotion before the deity. And that is the origin of the Odissi dance, classical Odissi dance. So far as literature is concerned, one of the most influential factors in molding our poetry, our philosophy, our thought process is Bhagavata retold by Jagannath Das. And he did it sitting under the banyan tree in the temple campus. Dear friends, vast is the culture. I believe I should not proceed further. This is just a brief introduction. A kind of enticement I am presenting to you so that you will be more interested in the mighty history of this country, of this land, and its cultural saga. Thank you very much. I wish you all the best.